This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. A few announcements this morning from St. John's. Thank you to everyone who donated school supplies for Marion School District. We were able to drop off a box of school supplies this last week. You should have received the newsletter by now. If not, give us a call at the office and we'll send one your way. Quilts and school kits, over 150 quilts and 15 school kits were dropped off for Lutheran World Relief last week. Sunday school families, this one's for you. Be on the lookout for a video on Facebook regarding Sunday school today, as well as an email about a survey of how we can do Sunday school for your families during this time. The quilters are encouraging you all to join them. They gather on Wednesdays from 12:30 to 1:30, and they are a pretty fun group to be with. They also want to say thank you to everyone who has donated sheets and fabric, sewing materials, thread, all of that that has made putting these quilts together possible. The last announcement I have is written about in the newsletter, but want to bring it to everyone's attention. We will be doing drive-by communion and incorporating communion in our worship service 2 weekends from now. So you are invited to come on Saturday, October 17th, between 9 and 11, and Sunday, October 18th, between 9:30 and 11:30, if you weren't able to make the Saturday time, to pick up your communion elements as well as Sunday school bags for the Sunday school families. If you aren't able to come get elements that day, that's okay. There's grace for that. We'll figure it out. This is not going to be the only time we do a drive-by communion. And honestly, you can use bread and wine that you have at home. So put that on your calendar, keep that in mind. And let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Let us pray. Beloved God, from you come all things that are good. Lead us by the inspiration of your Spirit to know these things that are right, and by your merciful guidance, help us to do them through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. So in today's gospel lesson, we hear about people in the vineyard and giving people money and them not getting it back. And it's really kind of confusing. And so as I was thinking about it, I thought about how really what it comes down to is even when we make mistakes, God fixes it. God fixes us. So even though we're broken, and even though we sin, and even though we mess up, God fixes those mess ups. And so I thought today I'd show you a little magic trick. Now bear with me, I'm not a magician, and I learned this just a few hours ago, but let's see. So I'm gonna tie a knot in this piece of twine, maybe. We'll see. Nope, not there. Let's try again. All right, we've got a knot, right? Can we see the knot? It's there. It's not going anywhere. And let's see. I'm gonna cut this right here. The knot is still there. Knot, see that? The knot's still there. All right, we're gonna do it again over here because, you know, we usually mess up more than once. And we do it again.
Tai are not again. Maybe. That looks about right. And then we're gonna cut this one too, because, you know, just make sure that it's a knot. And so, like we hear in the parable, God fixes things. And no matter how many times we mess up or how many knots we have in our twine, God fixes it. And so as I wind this up, I'm just gonna keep going. And then when I pull it out, there's no more knots. And it's one piece of twine. You saw me cut the twine multiple times, and here it all is, because God keeps making things new. Let us pray. God, we thank you for today, and we thank you for all the ways you act in our lives. We thank you for being there when we mess up, when we make mistakes, and when we miss the mark. God, we love you, and we need you, and we can't live without you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Our first reading today is from the book of Isaiah, the 5th chapter. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. Here ends the reading. Our gospel text today comes from the book of Matthew, the 21st chapter. Jesus said to the people, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and he built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned yet another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance.' So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants, who will give him the produce at harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone'? This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on the stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. The gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Today's reading from the book of Isaiah reminds me of a sad love song. It's a love song written by a prophet about God's love of and relationship with this vineyard, which is a metaphor for the people of Israel and Judah, and how, as time passes, the vineyard doesn't produce, and Israel and Judah don't do as God hoped. God found a piece of land and invested God's time to make the land a vineyard, something that would be protected, special, and fruitful. There was a watchtower built so those who worked there could make sure it was protected. There was a wine vat created in the space to make it special and not just another field. There was the expectation that this particular vineyard would produce good fruit because of the time and energy that God continuously put into it. But what if this passage in Isaiah isn't actually talking about a vineyard, but is using the vineyard as a metaphor for the people of Israel and Judah? the people of Israel and Judah who held promise. You see, God worked on these individuals and helped them to see what was right, and as a result, God was hopeful. Very hopeful, in fact, that they would indeed produce good fruit, or would at least be good people. God invested time and energy into these people, crafting and shaping them to be a people that would carry God's name across the earth. And only when it came time to harvest and the crop wasn't what God imagined it to be, God was left confused, frustrated, and wondering what in the world was going on. I know that somewhere along the way, God feels as if God let God's people down. But where did that happen? Did it happen as God was investing in God's people? Did it happen when God wasn't physically holding their hand, hoping they would do the decent thing? Did it happen when God made God's self known? In any case, God did what God thought was best for the people of Israel. And now, out of spite, God will punish these Israelites and Judah and people from Judah from our reading, or this particular vineyard. Three different things happen in the next few verses. God removes the protection around the vineyard, allowing animals and people to wander through the vineyard, trampling over what had been worked on tirelessly. In the same way, the protection came down, allowing other tribes and nations to attack Israel for whatever reason. The vineyard was not going to be taken care of anymore, letting the weeds grow wild. The Israelites were not going to be invested in as a special people anymore. They were going to know God, but not in the same way. And the vineyard wasn't going to be as well watered, letting the grapes and other plants growing die a slow death. The Israelites, without the special attention they've grown accustomed to, are likely going to wither and not be the people that God imagined them to be. They will likely be more interested in things that serve and profit themselves, not the things that are best for their people as a whole. In the gospel text, the same story is brought up from Isaiah by Jesus, except this time it's told a little differently. This time it's not as abstract, as Jesus tells the people exactly was and wasn't happening. The people who Jesus was talking to would have understood exactly what he was saying. Because back then, landowners leased land to tenants all the time. And instead of trading money as rent, the landowners expected a portion of the crop the tenants were caring for. If this transaction didn't happen as the landowner wished, they would replace the tenants with others they thought would be more generous and would agree to their terms. So in some ways, this is another parable about patience. Instead of immediately telling the tenants to find a new place to live or a new vineyard to tend, the landowner gave them multiple chances. He sent his slaves to collect what the tenants owed him as their rent. When that didn't work, he sent more slaves than the first time. And when that didn't work, the landowner thought for sure the tenants would respect his son and give him what the landowner was due. But that didn't happen in the case of this parable, or in the case of Jesus being sent to earth. The leaders chose not to believe that Jesus was the Messiah, the Son of God, the one sent to save all people from their sins. They consciously chose not to believe all that he said and promised. They consciously chose to go about things their own way, not taking into consideration the reality that Jesus better understood what was coming. They consciously chose to reject him, believing their own way was better than anything Jesus could ever bring or promise. So they went about building what worked for them, a life that was convenient for them. And in the process, they lost sight of the bigger picture. The religious leaders and all those in the crowd who demanded that Jesus be crucified didn't necessarily realize that they didn't ever really have the authority to demand such a thing. The power was never really theirs to begin with. In the same way that the fruit in the vineyard was never really the tenants to have. They were the ones to care for it. But ultimately, that fruit belonged to the landowner, the one who picked and chose the land to begin with. While we might not be tenants, tasked with taking care of a physical vineyard, we have been tasked with other responsibilities and other types of vineyards. We have been asked to care for one another by doing what we can to protect others, such as wearing our masks, staying away from others when we may be sick, and only doing things that are essential. We have been asked to steward our resources wisely, not taking advantage of all that is available to us, but only using what is absolutely necessary. By turning off lights, using reusable bottles and containers when possible, recycling, and so many other things. We have been asked to care for the world around us because we are only here temporarily. So how have we been like the tenants and taken things into our own hands? How have we been like the tenants and not given a portion of what we have to others because we think it is ours and only ours? How have we been like the tenants and forgotten whose we are? Because in the end, all of this belongs to God. We belong to God. And God cares for us and invests in us and trusts us and loves us more than we could ever know. Amen.
Thank you.
With confidence and God's grace and mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Holy God, you have called us to be your hands and feet in this world. Help us to work for peace and justice. May our service be a blessing to all we meet. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, as our fellow citizens who are victims of wildfires, hurricanes, and floods struggle to rebuild their lives and mourn their loved ones who have died, we pray for you to comfort them with calm seas and gentle, renewing rains. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Father, may we receive your blessings gratefully, use them responsibly, and from our bounty share generously, always remembering to give all glory to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comforting God, you give us the peace that passes all understanding. We ask for your peace in our going outs and our coming ins, in our labor and in our leisure, in our laughter and in our tears. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we ask for your compassion to caregivers and medical and skilled medical professionals who are dealing with the coronavirus and so many other things. May you continue to give them strength as the need for hospitalizations and treatment increases. May the families who have lost loved ones find comfort in knowing you were there to hold the hand of their beloved. We ask for your guidance and wisdom for medical researchers and personnel as they work to provide a vaccine. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we ask you to provide comfort and endurance to all who suffer hardship, hunger, or sleepless nights of pain or anxiety. We pray especially for Deb and Tammy, Gary, Mitch, Steve, Ken, Doris, Brian, Darla, and Grace. We also pray for all those we say aloud or silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. And let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now receive this blessing. Mothering God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you and lead you into the way of truth and life. Amen. Go in peace. Remember the poor. Thanks be to God.